Well, good evening. How's everyone doing tonight? I have one main concern for her. Some of y'all know what I mean, right? I tend to. So, she said I'm going to scoot over. So, I'm just joking. We actually, after supper, we were kind of reminiscing back there in the room. Ted, myself, and Brian, and some of the others, and when Pastor Jordan this afternoon was the third session, he said he just wanted to share some things from his heart with us. And he got kind of real serious, and I know I was kind of thinking, wait a minute, is he going to drop some, you know, did he get some diagnosis or something? So at any, and thank God it wasn't that. You know, we're grateful, Brother Jordan. We want you around for quite a bit longer, okay? So, but the guys, we were back there checking each other's ages out. Like, I'm 65. Ted said he's, where's Ted? Ted's 65. Where's Ted? Ted right there. And Brian is what, like about 26 or what? No, I'm whatever, 46, you know. So there truly is that sense that, you know, if the Lord tarries for another 50, 100 years and everything, then this generation, you know, it's going to be the younger generation. Charlie and you guys are going to be Mike and the others and going forward with the message of grace. And when you think about it from that perspective, it's really kind of, it's quite encouraging, because there's some young men that have seen the message of God's grace and are convicted about it out of the Word of God, not because of religion, but because of the power of Scripture to do that, and that are already in their young lives taking a stand for that. So we can certainly be encouraged about that. I do want to say again, thanks for the opportunity to be here with you today. We have several folks from the ministry there in Southern California. Simon Capistrano watching by way of the internet. My wife is watching too, so I gotta, you know, toe the line, whatever. But welcome to the folks listening on the internet as well. And when Brother Jordan gave me the topic, remembering or heeding Paul's warnings, it's a gigantic topic. So hopefully everyone had your coffee, you got your pillow, and, you know, we're going to be here for, the show's going to go on a long time. No, we're going to just try to deal with it as succinctly as possible. What I want to do then is, I want to begin with the word of prayer. Our gracious God and Father, we thank you for the time to look into your word this evening. We thank you for the wonderful day that we've enjoyed today, allowing your word to remind us about eternal things, and especially against the background of what we see happening, not only, of course, in our own country and in the various states that each of us are from. And there are people, Father, listening right now on the internet that are from really all over the world, from Brazil, from Norway, from Vietnam, Canada. And they too, as we have, are witnessing so many things going on in the world that just truly manifest the instability of humanity when they just turn off the light by rejecting your word and profess themselves to be wise, and they just manifest. The result is they just become fools. So, Father, as we continue to study your word this evening, we ask that you would equip us, enable us by your word to see the great warnings that you convey to the Apostle Paul for us to heed, but more importantly, not just to heed the warnings, to beware of them, but to understand that you have given us such a complete, full, total, complete position and provision in the Lord Jesus Christ and in your word, that we don't need to fear, that we can just walk by faith, trusting your word to do your work and to be laborers together with you in the endeavor. And we'll thank you for this in Christ's name. Amen. In the secular business community, there is a statement that people use to when they're starting a project, starting a plan, big or small, whatever. And it's the idea, I'm sure you've heard it before, it's the idea, begin with the end in mind. Have you all ever heard that? Begin with the end in mind. So what I want you to do is I'm going to ask you to open your Bibles at this point over to 1 Timothy chapter 6 and 2 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and 2 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and 2 Timothy chapter 3. So with that idea, when it says begin with the end in mind, what I want to do is I want to tell you where I want to, where I hope to end the message, where I hope to get to. And because there's a chance I'm not going to get there, I'm going to give it to you at the start. Is that okay? All right. So, but we'll see how it goes, okay? And it's real simple where we want to get to. I'm going to have you look over to, did I say 1 Timothy 6? 1 Timothy 6. Look at verse 12. And it's going to be, I'm going to use three phrases here. It'll be three key words just to remember. Look at verse 12. Notice it says, fight the good fight of faith. You see that there? Everybody see that there? So just kind of in your mind, put that word fight. Hold that thought and come with me over to 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 14 says, but what? But continue. So that's the second word. But continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. And then look at chapter 4 and verse 2. Anybody want to guess the third word? Yeah, how about preach? You see that there? Preach the word. So that's, now that, by the way, that isn't my outline. I'm not that organized. But at any rate, okay, that's the idea. That's where we want to get to. We not only want to take the time to look at some of the places in Paul's epistles where he tells us what to beware of and take heed about, but really what we want to do is to understand how God, through his word and by our position he's given us in Christ, has completely, totally equipped us, given us everything that we need to not only experience the afflictions and sufferings of this present time, but to live out of the resource of Christ, who already is. In him we already are more than a conqueror. So you see what we want to do today? So those three words. First word was what? Second word was what? And the third was what? Now think, go back to that first one here just a moment, if you would, over in 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm sorry, 1 Timothy 6. 1 Timothy 6 at verse 12 there. Think about that phrase there, fight the good fight of faith. There are a lot of fights going on right now all over the world, whether it's, say, political fights, economic fights, election fights, vaccine, COVID fights, all kinds of stuff. All over the world, all kinds of fights. And that one, when you think about that, it says, fight the good fight of faith. There is a fight that is worth the fight. It's worth taking every fiber of your being and engaging full force. And it's the fight of faith, the fight of believing God's word. And of course, when I say believing God's word, I'm talking rightly divided, and in the English language, I'm talking about a King James Bible. When you think about what you're going to get involved in terms of what you're going to put your energy in, that is going to make a difference not only for eternity, but in your life here at time, but in the lives of others, just keep that verse in mind. Keep that statement in mind. Is it what I'm, the fight that I'm engaging in, is it worth engaging in? Is it worth the battle? The word of God in that passage right there, our apostle says, fight the good fight of faith. That tells us something else as well. We'll see a little more detail about when he says fight. Well, what's going on? What's going on? Yeah, there's a war. Yeah, it's late, isn't it, right? I'm just getting started. Okay. The fact that he starts that phrase and says fight the good fight of faith, he's not soft-pedaling anything. He's telling us how it is. We absolutely are involved in spiritual warfare. Like, we'll see more about that just momentarily. But when he says, fight the good fight of faith, that means that the heart of this fight is a battle as to whether or not we're going to keep believing God's word, rightly divided, out of the King James Bible. That's at the heart of it. It's whether or not we're going to keep believing God's word, rightly divided, out of a King James Bible. And again, I know the Word of God is available in other languages. I talk English, and not very good at that. But so when you talk about what Bible you're going to use, it's a King James Bible. Have you ever had any discussions with other believers about the Bible issue? How many of y'all have had discussions with other believers about the Bible issue? Let me ask you a question that might even be a little bit more home to the group here. How many of you had interesting conversations with other mid-Acts Pauline dispensational grace believers about the King James Bible? And they're on the other side of the argument, okay? Totally on the other side of the argument, all right? So So understand that when that verse says, fight the good fight of faith, make it a conscious, making a conscious choice that okay, Lord, I'm going to believe your word today. I don't know about tomorrow. I don't know about next week. I'm not there yet. I'm here now. I don't know about a year from now. I don't know about 20 years from now. I hope 20 years from now I'll believe, Lord. But you know, Lord, I'm going to make a conscious choice to believe your word today, to trust it today, to rest in what it says today. And I'll deal with that same choice tomorrow, but I'm not living tomorrow yet. I'm here now, today. And Lord, I'm just going to believe your word. And when I say believe your word, I'm talking about rightly divided. And I'll even say it this way. I'm talking about hard, right division. There's another whole branch of those that would, to some degree, align themselves with a mid-axis Pauline dispensationalism, but what they do is they say, well, you just don't want to press it too hard. Well, okay, that's, you know, you're free to make that choice. But when that verse says, fight the good fight of faith, friends, that involves everything. It involves what you're going to do with the message, whether you're going to fly the flag of what you believe, whether you're going to, well, we got new people coming in, we had, you know, visitors come, so you can't preach it too hard. Well, why not? Why would you soft pedal the answer? Why would you soft pedal the Lord Jesus Christ? Would you soft pedal the Lord Jesus Christ to a lost person? Well, then why would you soft? Not you, but I'm saying, well, why would you go along with the idea of soft pedaling the Word of God about the divide? It's what they need. So, never says, fight the good fight of faith. It's a conscious choice. I'm going to trust your Word today. And then tomorrow you make the same decision, assuming you get to tomorrow, right? Maybe the rapture happens, by the way. All right, and the next day you just talk to the Lord about that same decision, and the next day same thing, and pretty soon what happens is you string a couple of weeks together, and then a couple of months together, a couple of years. Pretty soon you find you strung a lifetime together, and when you look back, you realize, wow, it really wasn't me at all. It was the power of God's word to do God's work, and I had to wrestle with myself every day, whether or not I'm going to fight the good fight of faith to this day. By the way, if you get to the end of the day and you realize you didn't do such a good job, you know what? Get over it. Get over yourself. Don't beat yourself up. Don't get down on yourself. You say, Lord, I was just living in the flesh today. And the Lord says, you think I didn't know? You know, the Lord is so wonderful when you just talk to him. You know that? And, you know, maybe things didn't go so well that day. You know what? You're still in Christ. Sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. You can make a different decision tomorrow. And the fact that you're even dealing with that, say, you know, it's the day's over, you're fixing to go to bed, you're thinking about it, the fact that you're thinking about it sets you up to continue in the fight. So you fight the good fight of faith. And friends, that's what it is. Turn with me, if you would, to Ephesians in chapter number 6 here. It's vital that we remember when heeding Paul's warnings, they really are warnings. He's not messing around, okay? It's not like if you're playing tennis and, you know, and you lose a match. Well, okay, you lost the match. It's not that big a consequence and so forth. Now, some of y'all, if y'all are major tennis players, maybe I just insulted you. I did not mean to insult you, okay? Right? But these warnings are serious. They're real. And when you look at a passage like this in Ephesians, and did I say chapter 6? Ephesians chapter number 6, look at what he says here, verse 10. You know the passage, he says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord. So we got to know who we are in Christ. And then the power of his might. We have to have experienced and learned the power of his might. The power of his might is his word. So we want to be strong in our awareness and appreciation of who we are in him. And we want to be strong in having come to see and realize and experience the power of his word working in us. The power of his might. You see that? And then he says this. We're not going to read this whole extended passage because we have a lot of other things to look at. Not that this isn't important. But watch what he says. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of who? How many of y'all believe that there really is a person, an actual created being, the devil, who he's Satan? How many of y'all believe that? What percentage of Christianity do you think actually believes that anymore? They really don't. They believe the devil is just kind of a concept, just an idea. But the devil is a real person, a created being. And when that verse says that we wrestle against the wiles, what are wiles? What's that? That's like tricks, okay? For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness. Think about that phrase right there, the rulers of the darkness. The rulers of the darkness. There are those whose job is to maintain the darkness. In the Bible, the darkness is a clear picture of the lie. So the rulers of the darkness, their job is to maintain the lie program. Essentially, fundamentally, where did the lie program start? Yea, hath God said. See that? And every single false doctrine of any kind, any shape, any form, is an offshoot of that one phrase, yea, hath God said. Okay? So understand that when that verse says the rulers of the darkness, their job is to maintain the lie, to maintain the darkness, the spiritual blindness that's out there. And then it says this, that against spiritual wickedness in high places. What are those high places? Those are the heavenly places. So you can see in that verse, and I'm not going to get into all the detail in that verse at this point, but you can see that the Apostle Paul identifies in that passage the chain of command that Satan and his cohorts operate from. It's fascinating how he does that in that verse. So many times in Paul's epistles, he tells us really exactly how the adversary operates, how his plan functions and so forth. And you can see his chain of command identified right there. Okay, so from the high places all the way from Satan all the way down to those that are the rulers of the darkness, their job is to maintain the darkness. The way that it... So therefore, make sure that we get the impact of this passage here. We are involved in a spiritual warfare. We are. We are, friends. We've got to let that sink in our thinking. That we really and truly are involved in, some people describe it as the great angelic conflict. That's not a bad way to think about it. The great conflict between God and Lucifer, who is now Satan, the devil. We really are involved in a spiritual warfare. Think about it this way, and I've said this before on different occasions, that when you go out and share the gospel with someone, think about what the Bible, what the Word of God is. The Word of God is quick and powerful. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit, and then what? And of the joints and marrow. And it's a discerner of the thoughts and intents of what? Of the heart. Does someone have to believe? This is not a trick question, okay? Does someone have to accept and believe God's Word in order for God's Word to get their heart? Someone said no, and that's the right answer. In the book of Acts, Peter's preaching to Israel. Most of them didn't believe. It said they were pricked in their heart. It got their heart, friends. It also said they were cut to the heart. That's a reference to those who didn't believe it. Listen, every time you take God's word, whether it's you reading God's word and your heart is open to it, or whether you or when you take God's word and you convey it to a lost person and so forth, it is getting to the heart. It's pricking it. It's cutting it. Whether or not they accept it is not what that phrase means, that it pricked them and cut them and so forth. Now, it's wanting to get their heart and open it up and so forth. But the point is that the Word of God is the power of God to reach the heart of man. And the Word of God is the only thing that has the power to actually penetrate beyond that hardness of the flesh and everything and the pride. And it goes into the ear, or if they read it through the eyes, and it gets right to the heart. That's what it does. So when we share the Word of God with people, we really don't need to be overly concerned so much with, oh, that person didn't get saved, so I failed. If they don't believe the gospel, did you fail? You didn't, did you? Just put the word out there. Just put the word out there. Put the word out there. So overall, Satan's objective is to hinder that from happening. Now, go with me, if you would, over to Philippians and chapter number 3. So understanding that we're in a spiritual warfare, it's real. When we say it's spiritual, we're not saying it's not real. It's very real. And it is a battle over, yea, hath God said, competing with God said. So it's a battle over the word of God. It's a battle over what God said. And therefore, it's a battle over the souls of humanity, as it were. And in Paul's epistles, he actually tells us, he gives us different glimpses or pictures of the sources of where that darkness maintaining information, where it's going to come from. And it comes from people. It comes from people, right? Doesn't come from dogs and cats and fish. It comes from people. Look at these verses. Look at this Philippians chapter number 3 here. Philippians in chapter number 3. He says at verse 1, he says, "Finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed is not grievous, but for you it is safe." Don't you love that verse? To be reminded about the grace of God, the word of God, that we're in Christ, we're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. To be reminded about that again and again and again and again. That is safe. There's spiritual protection in renewing our mind again and again with sound doctrine. You think Pastor Jordan here from this pulpit and the various men that preach from this pulpit and the various grace ministries that have happened, each year at Grace School of the Bible and all the conferences, you think we've said some of these same verses a few times over the years? Yeah. Why do we keep repeating the same thing? Because there's safety in it. See that? That verse makes it very, very clear. To write the same things to you, he says, to me it's not grievous, but for you it's safe. There's spiritual safety in being reminded about who we are in Christ and why we are who we are in Christ. He goes on to say, look at verse 2. Look at that first statement. What's it say there? Do any of you have neighbors that have that posted on their fence? Next time you see your neighbor and he's got that posted on his, he or she's got that posted on their fence, you just say, you know what? I didn't know you knew the Bible. They're going to look like, what? Yeah, you got it posted right on your fence. They might take that down, by the way. Okay. Beware of dogs. Anyway, the point is, look what he says here. Beware of dogs. Beware of evil workers. Beware of the concision. You see the three groups there? We're not going to get into all the details of who they represent and so forth, but the point is, they're people. They're people. And there's a common thing, though the specifics of what each group is preaching, the dogs, the evil workers, and the concision, notice he just left off the circumcision, they're just cutters. Obviously, that's just apostate religious Israel in that phrase. But there's a common thread that goes through, that is contained in the messages of each of those three groups. Look at the next couple of verses and you'll see what it is. For we are the circumcision, which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Christ Jesus. Now, what's that last statement say? And have what? No confidence in the flesh. The common thread that links those three groups or categories of doctrine and information together, the dogs, the evil workers, and the concision, the common thread is to one degree or another, they're all promoting a message that leads to having confidence in the flesh. Everybody see that? Now, confidence in the flesh to do what? Ride a bicycle? Play golf? Right? Some of y'all are big golfers, right? I just have never gotten into. What's that famous book about golf? It says, How to Ruin a Perfectly Good Walk. Something like that, you know? And my boys love golf. They've gotten into golf the last 5 or 6 years, and they turn out to be pretty good at it and so forth. But so is that verse talking about no confidence in the flesh to play golf or throw a frisbee? No. What's the idea of and having no confidence in the flesh? Well, think about it this way. In fact, look at what he goes on to say. Though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinketh that he hath, whereof he might trust in the flesh. Notice confidence and trust. You see the interplay of words there? We're the last two words of that verse. Five more. He's not exaggerating, friends. The Holy Spirit is the one that gave him those two words. When Paul looks at his life, and he's going to go on and give you the details of what he was trusting in, he says it's all done. He lists all those things there that were scriptural, they were biblical. And by the way, prior to the dispensation of grace, they even were right division biblical, right? Before Paul was saved, the dispensation of grace hadn't come in yet. So all those things in that program mattered. And so you can see that in the context when he says, have no confidence in the flesh. The common thread with every message out there, it's going to connect it all together. Any message that is opposed to the message of Pauline grace and right division and so forth is a message that somehow, some way, in some form or shape, is going to lead you to have confidence in the flesh. The flesh either to get saved, so you're trusting yourself. The flesh to stay saved, so you're trusting yourself to hang on. The flesh to prove you're saved, so now you're worthy of it. You see, the confidence in the flesh at all levels. How come your flesh is not involved in justification? How come God doesn't look to the flesh for your justification? That's true that it's not of works, but why does he not look to the flesh for justification? The flesh is already condemned, friends. It's already condemned. Why is it that God doesn't look to the flesh of a believer for sanctification? Same problem. If the flesh is already condemned in a lost person, listen, we've learned that the flesh hasn't gotten any better in a saved person, right? How many of y'all have learned that? You can put your feet up and hands in the air, right? The idea of quote-unquote biblical Christianity, Pauline right division grace, is not the improvement of the flesh. But that is the idea that people seem to think that we're conveying, that the job of biblical Christianity is go around and tell everybody else how they're all messed up, they're living wrong, and come and be like me, because I'm like Jesus. No, that's not the message at all. All that, again, is pointing to confidence in the flesh. You see that? So you can see in a passage like this, the different sources, and in the context, again, he'll give you what it's going to, not only how it's going to be presented, but how it's packaged. It's packaged with the idea that if you want to really please God, by the way, how many of y'all want to please God? Anybody here? Want to please God? Anybody want to please God? Okay. How many of you want to do as well? How many of you want to do better in your life as a believer? How many of you want to, quit whatever it is that you've been trying to quit that you haven't quit yet and start doing whatever you think you ought to be doing? How many want to do that? Yeah. And so religion comes along, those three groups. You got the dogs, evil workers, the concision. And they've got their ideas of how to do all that. Now what we're going to do, I want you to go to Colossians this time. We're going to go to Colossians chapter number 2. And we're going to look at four, and if we have time, maybe five different examples of what this is going to look like when it's being presented. The passage in Philippians that we just looked at identified like the three groups, as it were, and the common thread. Here in Colossians 2, you're going to see that Paul makes it very clear. He lays out the plan of the adversary, what it's going to look like, how it's going to be presented. And because we have a lot of verses to go through, we're not going to be able to drill down in great detail on necessarily any of them. That's not the point. You can do that on your own study time. We just want to kind of get the flow of what he's doing here so that we can really, truly heed Paul's warnings. Be on guard. And not only does the Apostle Paul in this passage here, in this extended passage here, this, by the way, this is not the only place he does this, but this is, to me, it's all together. That's, I figured we'd do it here. But what the Apostle Paul does in identifying for us here how the false information of having confidence in the flesh, what it's going to look like, how it's going to be presented. But what he does more importantly here, he tells us how we've already been equipped so as not to fall for it. Does that make sense how I said that? So watch what he does here. I'm going to start at verse 1. And again, it's an extended passage of Scripture. We don't have time to get into all the details about it. That is not the point. He says, "For I would that you knew what great conflict I have for you and for them of Laodicea, and as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ." Now stop there for just a moment. You see the idea of the full assurance? Just when you read that verse, does it kind of stir you up in a good way? Just when you read that, you go, wow, I mean, God, the word assurance is a good word. I may not understand anything else in the verse, but the word assurance is a good one, so there must be something good in that verse, right? So when you read down through those verses right there, you can see the Apostle Paul wants the Colossians here, and by extension, therefore you and me, to really have that full assurance of understanding. And of course, he talks about the mystery of the Father and of God and of Christ. Now look at the next verse. It says, "In whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." Let me read it differently. "In whom are hid some of the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." Let's just say that it said it that way, which it doesn't say it that way. But let's just say it said, "In whom are hid some of the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." Therefore, what would that verse demand? Yeah, where are the rest of the gold and riches and rubies and diamonds, right? You understand that? That verse doesn't say it that way. That verse says, "In whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." So if it's the treasures of wisdom and knowledge that we are seeking, where should we look? Say it loud, I want to hear it. Say it loud. Tell the people on the internet can hear you. Where should we look? We should look in the Word of God, rightly divided. We should look and expect to find the treasures of wisdom and knowledge in Him. By the way, hold this verse here. Go with me, if you would, to... I got to be careful not to get off track, which I'm doing, but we're going to come right back. Okay, I want to go to Hebrews 10. Sorry. Go to Hebrews 10 here. Watch this. Look at this passage here. Hebrews chapter number 10. This passage is talking about the Lord Jesus Christ. Hebrews 10:5, it says, "Wherefore when he is Jesus Christ there. Hebrews 10:5 says, "Wherefore when he cometh into the world, he saith, the coming of Jesus Christ into the world made this statement." It said this about the Father, "Sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not." That is, he wouldn't accept, as it were, because they didn't take away sin. "But a body hast thou prepared me to be that acceptable sacrifice," by the way. He says, "In burnt offerings and sacrifices for sins thou hast had no pleasure." How come? Because they didn't solve the problem. They didn't provide full payment for sin. Now watch verse 7. "Then said I..." Now who's the I in that verse? That's Jesus Christ. "Then said I, lo, I come," now watch the parentheses, "in the volume of the book, it is written of me." We talk about the Bible being 66 books, and it is. But it's just one volume. And the whole volume speaks about who? It's all about Him, friends. It's all about the Lord Jesus Christ. He said so. He believed that it was about Him. By the way, that's why he lived in absolute total dependence on what it said. That whole issue about the faith of Christ, I know some people have a hard time with that doctrine. It's one of the most blessed doctrines in all the Word of God. Seeing Him in His humanity, not denying His deity, but in His humanity, knowing that the volume of the book was about Him, doing the will of His Father. Well, you take that idea when he says, "In the volume of the book it is written of me." So you go back to Colossians chapter number 2, and he says about the Lord Jesus Christ at verse 3, "In whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge." Now, why would Paul have to tell the Colossians that? Look at the next statement, and here's the warning. Here's what we need to be cautious about and be aware of. "And this I say, lest any man should..." What? beguile you with enticing words. What does the word beguile mean? What's that word mean? Deceived, kind of tricked, whatever. Okay, and it says there, and this I say, lest any man should beguile you with enticing words. Enticing, what are enticing words? Words that do what? They entice you to do what? What do they do?
Covet,
lust, lead you away. Well, so in the context, if he just got through telling the Colossians, listen, all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge of God, they're in Christ. And I'm telling you this, lest someone comes along and beguiles you with enticing words. Words that entice you to think what? Different than what? That the treasures of wisdom and knowledge that are in Christ, they're pretty good, but they're not all there. You see that? He's warning them to be aware of the fact that all those, whether it's, he says, beware of dogs, the evil workers, the concision, whoever they are, somewhere in their message, what they're going to fundamentally say is, yeah, what you have in Christ and who he is, it's pretty good, and it's treasures and it's wisdom and knowledge, but there's more to be found over here. You see the idea there? So think about what people do with that then. Think about the average preaching that happens in churches across the globe. How many of them actually even use the Bible? They'll put a screen up there. And so people don't even bring their Bible anymore. They don't. And so they'll put this verse from this translation and that verse from that translation. And, oh, we found this one that'll back up what I want to say. Oh, and this will back up what I want to say. Because they got no authority. They've taken the source of all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge and set it aside and have beguiled the Christian community and the world to think that the treasures of wisdom and knowledge can be found somewhere other than in its exclusive source. So Paul tells us this. He says, for though I be absent in the flesh, yet am I with you in the spirit, joying and beholding your order and the steadfastness of your faith in Christ. So they're standing pretty strong so far. And he says, now, so here's how to protect yourself from being beguiled with enticing words. Watch how simple it is, the solution. Is it getting really hot in here, or is it me? Okay, all right. Someone said yes, meaning is it me? Yes, y'all are getting me. Anyway, watch how simple the answer is. As ye have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord. Stop, hold it, wait. Okay, so how did you receive Christ Jesus the Lord? Did you have to work for it? Were you good enough? Did you have to pray and beg and give money and get baptized and all these religious things? Yes or no? You mean it was free? I get really sarcastic. Just I had to tell the guys on Zoom meeting, on Zoom Bible study, I said, just slap me across the face. I was afraid my wife was going to come up and do it, right? But when that verse says, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so go, if there's ever any doubt in your mind whether or not the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are to be found in Christ and Christ alone, then go back and ask yourself the question, how did my life in Christ begin in the first place? Oh, by grace and through faith. Truly a finished work of what Christ did. I'm the recipient. He was the giver. I'm the one coming with nothing to offer. And he offered himself full and free. So he says, as you have therefore received Christ your Lord, so walk in him. Well then, how does the Christian life work? The same way it began. It's a conscious choice, moment by moment, to believe God's word. It's a walk, okay? Lord, I'm gonna take one step. I'm gonna believe you right now. and I'm going to believe you now, and I'm going to believe I'm sealed in Christ now. It's just a walk of faith. You see that? See how simple it is? So the way to protect ourselves, the provision God's already given to us, when someone comes along and suggests that the treasures of wisdom and knowledge can be found somewhere other than in Christ, he says, wait a minute, how did you get in him in the first place? Walk the same way. But not only that, he goes on and says this, rooted and built up, where? Why would you want to be rooted and built up in him? Why would we want to take the roots of our life and have them sink deep in him? After all, aren't the treasures of wisdom and knowledge kind of limited in him? Don't we need to make sure the roots of our life go into this source and that resource and over here? Oh yeah, they're in Christ too. That verse says, rooted and built up where? In him, established in the faith as you have been taught, abounding therein. With what? Thanksgiving is such a vital part of this because it comes from a heart realizing the value of the treasure and therefore the value of the giver. So when we think of it that way, we realize, wow, someone comes along and tries to beguile me with enticing words thinking that, wow, I can go over here and find the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I'm realizing that that's not what that verse says. That's the very warning here. Quickly, let's move on. Look at what he says here. We won't have the time to take that much time on each one of these because we'll just never get through this. Look at his next warning, verse 8 now. Here's the second one in this section. He said, what's the first word there? What's that word mean? What's that word imply? What does the word beware imply?
Danger.
Yeah, danger's ahead. Watch out. You know, you're going around the curve. It says beware, curve in the road. Don't go straight. I mean, maybe you want to go straight, but... When he says in that verse, beware, lest any man spoil you. And that's the idea of spoil, not like rotten, but being taken captive in a battle. Remember, we're in a spiritual warfare. He says, beware, lest any man spoil you. What's the message, the messaging, I guess that's what they say, that they're going to use? They're going to use philosophy, vain deceit, tradition of men, rudiments of the world, none of which are after Christ. All those four categories of messages, they didn't originate from Christ. Look at what he goes on to say, which will help us appreciate the danger in those four categories identified in verse 8, the philosophy, vain deceit, and so forth. Look at what he says about Christ and who you are in him. Watch him go through the list. Verse 9. First of all, in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily. That's starting pretty high ground, don't you think? And ye are, what? Say it with me. What are you? You're complete in him. And he is the head of all principality and power. So wait a minute, Paul, you're telling me that as a result of being justified by faith alone in the blood of Jesus Christ, I have been made complete in the one in whom all the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily and who also is the head of all principality and power. You're telling me that's the one I'm complete in? Is he saying that? How complete are you? How complete are you? Yeah, completely complete. What percentage of the Godhead dwells bodily in Christ? How high up is Christ in relationship to being head of all principality and power? Like what percentage of governorship or rulership does he have over the principalities and powers? 100%. So you're complete already in the one in which 100% of the Godhead dwells bodily, and the one who is 100% the head of all principality and power. That's the one you're complete in. You see how the completeness, therefore, when he talks about you completing it, we're not the standard. Who's the standard? Christ is. Watch what he goes on to say. Verse 11, in whom also you're circumcised with the circumcision made without hands, putting off the body of the sins of the flesh by the circumcision of Christ. So guess what? Because you've been identified in him, you've already been circumcised from the flesh. You're already dead to sin. Verse 12, buried with him in baptism. The baptism that did the job, by the way, right? He says, buried with him in baptism, wherein also you're risen with him through the faith of the operation of God. Wait a minute. So verse 11, I've already been circumcised. Verse 12, I was already put in the grave with him. Verse 12, I've already been raised up with him, and God's the one that did the operation. You think that God, does God have to have any medical insurance, malpractice insurance? God has never, you know, they talk about when, it's a good thing they put you out when they do the surgery so you can't hear them talking about you and what they did. You can't hear them go, oops. I was supposed to take the left kidney, I took the right one, or whatever, you know. The faith of the operation of God who raised him from the dead. He goes on to say, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh, he's quickened together with him, having forgiven you how many trespasses? Is that good? Is that good news? And not only that, blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us. It was contrary to us. And he took it out of the way, nailing it to where? The cross. And not only that, verse 15. Having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show. He absolutely put on display by the cross and as disclosed through Paul's preaching of the cross, he made a show of them openly. So if I'm already complete in Christ, if I've already been cut apart from the power of the flesh in me, though I still live in the flesh, if I already have been raised up with Christ from the dead, if I've already been forgiven of all of my trespasses, all of my sins, if God has already taken the law, taken it out of the way, if the cross has already manifested Christ's victorious accomplished at Calvary there on my behalf and has manifested, put on display the adversary's program, go back to verse 8. Can philosophy improve on that? Can vain deceit add to that? Can the tradition of men make it better? Can the rudiments of the world make up for what I'm lacking? What are you lacking? You see his logic here. He not only tells us, watch out for this, you got to know you already have this. This is how to beware of this. He goes on to say, look at verse 16. Let no man therefore judge you in meat or drink or in respect of an holy day or the new moon or of the Sabbath days. Now, what are all those things? They are traditions. We won't have the time to look at it, but in your notes, write down Ezekiel 45:17. That statement is taken right out of the book of Ezekiel. And they're all details about the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. So when he says it this way, let no man therefore judge you in, what's this, meat or drink, or in respect of holy day, or new moon, or Sabbath days. What's happening? What's the warning there? Someone's coming along and trying to put you under those things. But in order to put you under those things, what do they have to do? We don't have the right division chart up here, but you guys are very familiar with the right division chart, and you know usually it's open, right? Or at least when we're drawing out, we should open up. So think of it this way. When he says, don't let anyone come and close the chart. What do I mean by that? Yeah, just blend it all together. When that verse says, let no man therefore judge you in meat or drink or respect of a holy day or the new moon or Sabbath days, which are a shadow of things, all of that, that's all in the future. That's not the present dispensation. That's, you see, and he says, but the body is of Christ. What God is doing today is forming the body of Christ. So his warning in that verse is someone's going to come along and they're going to deceive you by failing to rightly divide. They're going to say, no, no, there's no difference between the dispensation of grace and the kingdom program. It's all the same thing. You see the warning there? And the solution is, that's all in the world to come. The answer is, what God is doing today is forming the body of Christ. So we have to know where we are dispensationally. Look at the next one. Verse 18. Watch this now. Let no man beguile you. Beguile again? What's that mean? Like deceive, trick, whatever? Take something away from you that's yours? He says, let no man beguile you of your reward. By the way, there is a reward. It's another whole subject, all right? But he says, let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping. Okay, wait, stop there. The word voluntary. Is that kind of usually a pretty good word? Like free will, voluntary? How about the word humility? Is that kind of a good word? Yeah. How about worshiping? Oh, man, now we got to worship. So he couples three words together, voluntary, humility, worshiping. Man, how much more spiritual could we get? You see what he's doing there? But there's a gigantic problem here. Look at the source from which they are claiming to have received the information that they're presenting to their audience, that's leading their audience to voluntarily humble themselves in worship to that information. What's the source? Angels! Look at that verse. He says, voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen. You know the new translations change that. They take that word not out of there. But it says, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind and not holding the head. You know what that verse is talking about? Simply put, that verse is talking about information that they are claiming that has come from angels. So extra-biblical information. Oh, has there recently, the last couple of years, been a lot of talk about like the Book of Maccabees and fables and all that kind of stuff, all the Apocrypha. Y'all had much discussions about that lately. So think about that. Look at verse 19. And not holding, statement there? Who's the head? Who's that? In the verses, you have two sources of information. Angels, supposedly, the head. The Lord Jesus Christ. Who are you going to listen to? You see his warning here? Who are you going to listen to? So you got someone come along saying, wow, I got a message from heaven. Yeah, you better watch out. Right? So you can see in the sequence here, he says you gotta understand where the true treasures of wisdom and knowledge are. They're in the right person. And you're complete in that person. You got to make sure you understand where you are dispensationally. And you got to use the right book. Not extra biblical stuff. So, verse 20. If you be dead with Christ from the rudiments of the world, why is there living in the world? Okay, I got a question. Let's say you walk up to this dead guy on the street. He's just a dead guy. He's just there. You can kick him. You can... you know, slap him on the face, pour cold water. He's not going to get out. He's dead. So you call the religious person and you say, okay, come on here, just got this dead guy here, religious person. Come and do what they call the last rites. Have you ever heard that? And so they come and they sprinkle water on this guy and the holy incense or smoke or whatever, you know, and they put the ashes, whatever. Did that do anything to that dead guy? And Paul is saying, you're already dead. The death that matters, you already experienced. The death that's going to determine your eternal destiny, you already got it. When you were baptized into the death of Jesus Christ. The Apostle Paul says, the body's already dead. I know none of us in our flesh like death. Yeah, it's. But Paul says, hey, get over it. The body's already dead because sin has been condemned where? In the flesh. He says, the body's dead because of sin. The body's already dead. The death that matters, the death that's going to determine your eternal destiny, you already got it. And it's God the Holy Spirit who baptized you into Jesus Christ's very death, burial, and resurrection. So he says at chapter 3, verse 1, if you then be risen with Christ. You see the simplicity of his logic, his appeal here? That's not the if of doubt. It's the if of, well, challenge, appeal. Right? If he then be risen with Christ, where are we? Have we been? So Christ is where all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge of God are found. All the fullness of the Godhead dwells bodily in him. He's ahead of all principality and power. I'm complete in him. I've already been circumcised. Already been baptized with the right one. The one that mattered. The one that made the difference. I've already been forgiven of all my sins. And what he did at Calvary, not only for me, what he did at Calvary absolutely put on display the lie program. It exposed it. And as a result of me being raised up together with Christ, I've been set together with him in heavenly places. So chapter 3, verse 1, if you then be risen with Christ, you know what? Seek those things which are above. Where are we going to find that? In the Word. Where Christ is on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. He's talking about the earthly program. That verse is not saying you can't own a car. Or a set of golf clubs. Or a dirt bike. I love my dirt bike. Okay? I don't get to ride much anymore, but I sure enjoy it when I can. But that verse is, set your things on. That verse isn't saying you can't own a home. It says, set your affection on things above. That's it. The destiny of the body of Christ is the heavenly places, not the earth. He promised the earth to Abraham and his seed. Verse 3, for ye are dead and your life. Okay, now make up your mind, Paul. Am I dead or am I alive? What's the answer? Yes. He says, for ye are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. Don't you love that? Is God pretty good at, when he hides something, keeping it hidden and safe? Yeah, think the mystery. Your life is hid with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, shall appear. What's that say? Then maybe you'll appear with him in glory, if you're good enough. If you maintain, if you hold on, if you do better, if you promise more, you pray more, you give more, you dedicated more. No, it's not based on any of that. Then shall you appear also. Then shall you also appear with him where? In glory. Quickly, if you would, turn with me over to back over where we started, 1 Timothy 6. What do we do then? In every one of Paul's epistles, he has something to say about the various attacks from the adversary, what they're going to look like, what to watch out for. In every one of Paul's epistles, he has something to say about this. But as we want to kind of wrap this up here, look what he does. So back to 1 Timothy 6. So when he says in verse 12, you know what? Fight the good fight of faith. We're in a battle. We're in a fight. In Christ, we're already more than conquerors through him that loved us. We don't become a conqueror by us being strong enough. We are already more than conquerors through him. We just got to take our position in him. Just rest in our position. And that verse says, fight the good fight of faith. Just make a conscious choice on a moment-by-moment basis just to believe me, God's saying. Just trust me. You go to 2 Timothy chapter number 2. 2 Timothy chapter number 2, when he says it, Second Timothy 3, verse 13, he says, but evil men and seducers shall do what? It just wax worse and worse. That means they're going to get worse and worse, not better and better. And they're going to, it says, deceiving and being deceived. So what should we do? Well, it says, continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of. Okay, what did we learn? What did we learn tonight? What are some things we learned tonight? Anybody? What did we learn? Yeah, the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are found in Christ and him alone. Have we been assured of anything from looking at these verses? What have we been assured of? How about complete in Christ? He says, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned. That's a fascinating statement there. It says of whom, because Timothy not only learned from Paul, but how Paul said it to the Ephesians, that they heard Christ. How did the Ephesians hear Christ? Christ never went to Ephesus. They heard it from Paul. Back over to 1 Timothy 4. Brother Ted briefly touched on this last night. I'm just going to mention this again. Pastor Jordan mentioned it again this morning. Guys and girls and ladies, look at verse 16. 1 Timothy 4, 16. Look at that first statement there. Take heed unto who? Unto thyself. See that? We do need to watch out for ourselves. We've got to be on guard for ourselves. It's one thing to think about, okay, the assembly is going to face these things. Others are going to face these things. But you realize, you preach the message of God's grace out of the King James Bible, rightly divided. You know what? You're going to face these same things. So you got to have a conscious awareness of what you're going to stand for, what you're going to tolerate, who or what you are going to let influence your decisions, who you're concerned about, quote unquote, upsetting. Does that make sense? Oh, I don't want to say this because that'll upset that guy, and that guy's a whoever. We have to watch out for ourselves. It says, take heed unto thyself and unto the doctrine. Continue in them. For in doing this, thou shalt both save thyself and them that most hear thee. Those that will listen to what the Word of God, what the Bible says, they will be the ones that are saved from these various assaults of the adversary. And then go back to 2 Timothy chapter 4. So notice what he says. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verse 1. I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Two different events. Can we say verse 2 out loud, the first three words together? Ready? Here we go. Ready? Preach the word. You know what we need to do? Listen, friends. We just got to make a decision that, okay, the word of God, rightly divided out of King James Bible, is the power of God to work in my life. So I have to make a decision to stay in the Word of God and let it work in my life. The Word of God, right divided out of a King James Bible, is what will do God's work in the life of someone else's, in someone else's life. That means what we want to do is we want to just keep the Word of God doing the work of God by just keep preaching the word rightly divided. It all boils down to that. Keep standing for right division. Keep standing for the grace message. Keep standing for your King James Bible. Just making that the issue. Let's say you look back on your life as a believer 20, 30, 40 years go by, and someone says about you, they say, you know, that guy, he just never grew much, because the same things he's preaching today, he was preaching that 20 years ago. That guy just never grew very much. You think that actually is a good thing or a bad thing? You see that? If what we're preaching is the truth, and it is, if this is what God's Word says He's doing today, the body is of Christ, we've got to rightly divide the Word of truth. We have God's Word in our language in the King James Bible. Then we never need to apologize for someone that look back on your life and say, oh, you know, you're preaching the same thing you did 20 years ago. You've never grown. Well, maybe I've just grown deeper. Maybe those roots have just gone deeper. Maybe. I hope so. But if the accusation that someone makes against you, that, oh, you're just preaching the same old stuff, that Pauline mid-acts dispensationalism out of the King James Bible, that just, you know, that's, they're actually paying you a compliment. You know what I'm saying? Well, what's that? Yeah. Let's close in prayer. Our gracious God and Father, we thank you for the time to look into your word tonight. We thank you that we have your word. We thank you that we can trust what your word says. Your word is going to tell us the exact same things tomorrow that it told us today and told us the day before. You're faithful. We can trust you. And we know, Father, that that is the fight. The fight even in each and every one of us, our own flesh, that good fight of faith, the fight worth fighting, the fight to continue to make the choice every day just to believe your word, just to find rest and peace and assurance in who you've made us to be in such a wonderful, glorious, perfect, eternal Savior, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, in whose name we give thee praise and honor. Amen.